Police and ambulance are coming with motor vehicle accident victims.
He's quite uncooperative.
Hey, what have you had this morning?
Have you got your needles on you?
He's worried about taking his jeans off. Hey, slow down.
That's all right, that's all right.
As I'm uncovering him, I found something in his underwear.
Oh, look at that.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I've slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We're gonna staple your head back together. Rescue me.
There is a possibility he might die.
Would you rescue me?
Royal Melbourne emergency. Mark, there's two MVOs coming on, both in the same vehicle. One's agitated and doesn't want to
just
be here.
Trauma one, trauma two?
Yep, trauma one, trauma two.
The director of emergency, Dr. Mark Putland, is getting details about a high-speed car crash involving two victims about to arrive under police guard.
Five police is a lot of police.
Road accidents are the single biggest cause of major traumas at the Royal Melbourne Hospital.
Police and ambulance are coming with some motor vehicle accident victims. No seat belts, not being very cooperative, hence police are helping out.
It does start to paint a certain picture. We're always on our guard a little bit. We're a little bit more cautious, but we try to take a fresh start with each person.
The driver of the car arrives first and is rushed into trauma one in a critical condition.
Do not lift your head up. Do not.
He's been in a high-speed MVA. The area that really is complaining of pain is in the right side of his neck and his lower abdomen.
The team needs to move quickly to find any potentially fatal internal injuries and bleeding.
I'm going to have a little look at your tummy with the ultrasound, all right? At the speed that you tend to stop, things can kind of tear.
His blood pressure is low, his heart rate's high. We find evidence of bleeding in his abdomen.
Dr. Mark's also on alert for the second victim, who is the passenger in the car that crashed head-on into a stationary truck. He's highly agitated, and the situation is potentially volatile.
It could be a head injury, and 90 kilometres an hour head-on into another car, and being a bit uncooperative, anything's possible. Helps that he's coming with police. They come in and they've got him under control, and it takes that pressure off us a little bit. Come on in.
The man has been disruptive and uncooperative with the paramedics and acting very strangely.
Yeah, get on, mate.
Right there. Get on there.
Just wriggle over here.
Thank you, mate.
Good chap, good chap. Nearly there, nearly there. Well, that's the way. Okay, okay. Wrong side up. Roll over the other side. Hey, good man. All right, geez, you've had a rough day. All right.
Yeah, you can say that, mate.
My name's Mark, I'm one of the doctors.
Nice to meet you, mate.
What has happened to you today?
Man, I was off for a cruise and something seemed to go wrong.
Something's going to go wrong. Well, don't wriggle around too much because you're in the Royal Melbourne Hospital.
Why?
Because you had a crash.
Did I really?
The rear passenger, unrestrained, of a sedan hitting a truck. Left shoulder pain.
Just leave your head back. Leave your head back.
He's quite uncooperative and is almost on the nod as if he's affected by heroin or another drug. He has denied any alcohol or drug intoxication. I was unable to get him to comply with a collar or any other spinal precautions.
It's not aggro with you, just wriggling.
Correct. Uncooperative is a good word. There was no aggression.
Please.
If I need to put a collar on you, is that okay?
No, I don't want a collar. I'm not a dog.
The team must take the man's clothes off to examine him properly. But he seems reluctant.
You've got a right to be a goose in a way. Like, if people are allowed to be stupid, but if the reason they're being a goose is because they're really, really sick, or if it's just they're a goose. So it's a delicate balance. Hey, lie down, lie down. Go back to sleep.
For some unknown reason, the man continues to resist having his clothes removed. behaviour that's making Mark suspicious.
Keep your head still. You're covered, you're covered.
Royal Melbourne receiving.
Trump call.
Yeah. Carolyn, this guy that's coming in with the chopper.
It's the start of shift for Dr. Miriam Yasser, who's been at the Royal Melbourne for 2 years.
He's stable, open tip rib fracture, but his heart rate's 50.
The thing that I love most about my job is the interaction that I get to have with patients. You're in a uniquely privileged position where patients are at their most vulnerable, and I think that's incredible.
So do we know if the chop is coming into here or the...
The 80-year-old is coming here.
The 80-year-old?
Yeah.
Car, bike?
Bike.
Dr. Miriam and Nurse Maddie White are standing by for an incoming trauma. An air ambulance is arriving from rural Victoria with another motor vehicle accident. This time, it's a motorbike crash.
We see motorbike trauma quite frequently, and the ones that I have seen have been associated with quite a significant injury.
The 82-year-old man was thrown into the air and slid 6 metres into an embankment. He has multiple fractures and a dangerous case of nausea.
That first hour in hospital is so critical. You know, we call it the golden hour. And it's the make or break period of that trauma.
Can you give us a hand? He's just going to be sick. Just cut the Rex.
Yeah.
Just hold it for a tick.
We're just going to roll you to one side.
Can we get some droperidol, please, Maddie?
Droperidol?
Yeah.
The nausea and vomiting presents a time delay in how quickly we can get Rex to the scanner to assess if he does have any other injuries. Because he's lying flat in a collar and he's vomiting, it does pose a risk that he might choke on his vomit.
Ready, set, go. Rex, he was out on a group motorbike ride today, so he's riding a high-powered motorbike, full-face helmet. He's hit some gravel with his rear wheel and it's then high-sided, so it's skid out and it sort of flicked him up into the air.
Do you know how fast he was going?
So we're not really sure. It's an up to an 80k zone, so we'll say max 80k's.
Okay, and have we managed to contact any next of kin at all?
He lives with his wife.
Hi, Rex.
Hi.
How are you going? My name's Miriam. I'm one of the emergency doctors. I'm going to be taking care of you while you're here.
Good.
How long have you been riding for?
All your life.
All your life?
Straight away, Dr. Miriam organises an x-ray.
We're ready for an x-ray.
All right, anyone without lead, can you please leave the room?
Fractures for elderly people have different implications than they do for young people. Their bones are often a little bit thinner. They take longer to heal, and that also has implications for their recovery and rehab.
Okay, so we have tib-fib fractures.
Both bones in Rex's lower leg are badly broken and he'll need urgent surgery.
You've broken your leg, my darling. Your left lower leg.
Is a bit sore.
It's a bit sore. It's broken, so that's why it's sore. Yeah, okay. Have you ever had any accidents before this one? Have you?
14 broken bones.
14 broken bones. Well, you've added two more today.
Yeah.
The fact that Rex has broken multiple bones before this presentation doesn't really surprise me at all. The fact that he's made it to 82 with all of his injuries is a pretty great thing. I mean, it's amazing.
Because Rex crashed at high speed and was thrown into the air, Dr. Miriam wants a scan of his head and neck, looking for brain and spinal injuries. On the way, Rex takes a sudden turn for the worse.
Hey.
I feel like I might bring something up.
You're gonna bum out? If you vomit laying down, you're going to swallow it and it's going into your lungs and then you'll stop breathing.
Okay, thanks so much for the call.
Bye.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital's emergency department, Dr. Maya Cubitt's just taken a call about yet another road accident.
Emma, it's Maya.
Hello, how are you?
The spate of car crashes means Dr. Maya is juggling multiple patients. So she's handing this case to colleague Dr. Emma West, who's just down the corridor.
Good
There's a trauma coming in. It's a young woman who drove into a rock wall at about 5:30 this morning.
126.
Oh, there you are. Self-presented to Seymour Hospital with tachycardia,
yep.
Pain throughout her spine, her pelvis, altered
yep.
Sensation in her right leg.
Yep.
A young car crash victim with a disturbingly high heart rate is being transported by ambulance.
Trauma call's gone out?
Yes.
Yeah, good. I'll speak to her.
And there's a met pack coming.
Lovely. One of the things we're worried about is she's got a really fast heart rate of between 130 and 150. And we know that's a marker of a potentially severe trauma. So we're activating our trauma call criteria, which means we get surgeons, anaesthetists and nurses, a group of people together to work on the patient when they arrive.
Dr. Emma has assembled her team, but the rural ambulance is still en route.
I get really impatient and antsy when they're not here. But no one's here yet.
Potentially, this young woman has become more unwell on the way to hospital. Her heart rate's really fast, and the types of injuries that come to mind include hidden bleeding. That's what we're really worried about, and that can be life-threatening.
It's just calling about the trauma we're expecting. There's nothing popped up on the board, and the ETA was 15 minutes ago.
How's that pain now? Are you still in pain?
Back at the CT scanner, 82-year-old biker Rex is in a bad way. He was in a high-speed crash, fracturing his leg and causing a life-threatening case of nausea.
Feel a bit better now?
Horrible.
Yeah, I'll get you a little spot.
Dr. Miriam is concerned about the continual vomiting.
What pain relief have we given him here? He seems to have vomited after fentanyl with the ambulance and then after fentanyl.
Every time it was on movement.
So while Rex has his scan, Miriam investigates which pain relief to use while treating his fractured leg. The wrong choice could make the vomiting even worse. It's a critical decision. So Miriam gets advice from the physician in charge today, Dr. Michelle Thornhill.
The issue with him is that he's been quite nauseous. He's had a few vomits, mainly just on movement.
Maybe we could just try some dissociative ketamine.
Ketamine would have the least impact on things, including his blood pressure. We use it quite frequently to help sedate people, and it does provide a bit of pain relief as well.
All right, Rex, I'd like you now. Just think of somewhere nice you'd like to be. Nice holiday spot.
All right, Rex. We're just gonna lift up your leg, darling.
Good job, Rex. Just some nice, slow, deep breaths.
With Rex now sedated, Dr. Miriam splints the badly broken leg to keep it straight and prevent movement.
Just gonna give you a little bit more, Rex. Doing really well. All done. Sit well. Keep taking those deep breaths.
Earlier today, Rex had been enjoying a motorbike ride with a group of friends. And now he's in hospital facing emergency surgery.
I hate motorbikes. My husband rides a motorbike and he's now sold that, which is great. And my dad had a really bad motorbike accident when he was 22. So I hate them. They ruin lives.
Rex, how you feeling, darling? You okay?
People can sometimes react quite badly when they're coming out of their ketamine sedation, and that usually presents as them panicking or becoming a bit frightened.
Rex, I know it's horrible. You're okay. You're safe. You're safe, mate. You've just had a bit of ketamine that makes things feel a bit weird. Rex, it's Maddie, the nurse.
I'm there to reassure him, make sure that he doesn't feel alone in this really, really awful day.
You feel funny? Oh. Yeah. I might get your wife in. Would that be nice?
Rex's wife, Robin, and daughter, Belinda, are waiting anxiously outside the trauma bay, but they haven't been able to speak to him yet.
We're still waiting for some scan results. So we ended up scanning from his head to down to his ankle, just to make sure everything's okay. Waiting for those formal results to come back in the next hour to two. And then from there, we'll have an idea of how bad things are and if he's got other injuries, okay?
Rex and Robin have been married for 57 years.
I was trying to act as though everything would be fine, be confident, but then I also had to think that if he rides motorbikes, he's in an accident, there is a chance it could kill him.
You can come up, darling. Come up and hold his hand.
But at 82, to die doing what you love doing is better than, you know, not going out there and doing what you love.
Keep your head still,
Hey, lie down.
Down the corridor, Dr. Mark Putland has a double trauma on his hands, with two victims being treated in separate rooms after a high-speed car crash into a stationary truck. In Trauma Bay 1, the driver is in a critical condition with massive internal bleeding.
It's like God,
next door in Trauma 2, his mate and passenger in the car is behaving strangely. And Dr. Mark's trying to understand why.
Hey, what have you had this morning? You don't look like your normal self.
You don't know me.
What drugs have you had?
So for my patient, it doesn't seem like he's bleeding. His mental state has been peculiar and is now becoming sedated. Our concern really is to rule out a serious head injury.
What have you had? You did grog or something else?
So that you don't
move your neck around, because you don't have you broken. Okay, I'm just going to take a quick ultrasound of your belly.
Try and uncover every part of him, make sure he's okay.
You're covered.
Yeah, we're just getting you. We'll keep your blanket over your cods, okay?
With the patient continuing to resist having his jeans and underwear removed, Dr. Mark's suspicions grow.
You got anything valuable in your jeans pocket?
I got this sword.
So he decides to check inside the man's underwear to find the cause.
Look at that. Look at that. You got anything valuable in your jeans pocket?
Okay.
In Trauma Room 2, Dr. Mark Putland's car crash victim is acting suspiciously about having his pants removed.
Oh, look at that. Look at that.
Just pulled his jocks down to have a look, make sure there wasn't a big bleeding or bruising around his scrotum that can go with a pelvic fracture. As I'm uncovering him, I've found something in his underwear that starts to make sense of his behaviour.
No wonder he was worried about taking his jeans off.
Dr. Mark has found suspected illegal drugs in the man's underpants.
OK. So don't wash your hands with that hand gel, because I suspect it's... I suspect it's not. Well, hand gel is often not hand gel when it's kept in the underpants of people who also store bags of white powder in their underpants. Well, it explains why he's a bit peculiar today.
Next door in Trauma 1, the other victim involved in the high-speed car crash is seriously injured.
Do you still find him to be sick?
A little bit, yeah.
An ultrasound has found more than a litre of blood in the driver's abdomen from a torn bowel. As he's prepared for urgent surgery, the police get to work gathering evidence on his mate next door.
His undies. I didn't, no track marks anywhere.
That's all right. Mate, have you got any needles on you?
No.
In this type of case, the hospital is required to provide police with the patient's blood results after a motor vehicle crash.
So we've got this tricky balance. I don't want people afraid to come to hospital. Everyone should be able to come and get taken care of.
As the driver is taken for emergency surgery to repair his torn bowel, the passenger is taken to the CT scanner to check for any internal injuries.
Okay,
Please breathe in and hold your breath.
He's escaped the car accident relatively unscathed.
It's remarkable what people are able to get away with sometimes. This was, by the sounds of it, a pretty decent speed and a decent impact, and they've managed to get away with it, which is dumb luck, I suppose.
We've got a huge team ready, so we're just trying to figure out where they are. Hopefully they're here soon.
Dr. Emma West and her team are still waiting anxiously for their young car crash victim, who was due 15 minutes ago. Paramedics can only predict how long it's going to take them to get to hospital.
We are expecting a young woman to arrive from a rural location whose heart rate's really fast. And with that, we're really worried about internal bleeding or a significant injury from the car accident. And we've got news that they've just arrived.
In this case, the patient needed to be transferred en route to a mobile intensive care ambulance with life-saving specialist equipment on board.
As the patient comes in, our priority is to really figure out how that patient is going right now.
One, two, three. Nurse Julia Hoyles is on hand to help treat Laura.
Sorry, darling. We're just going to listen to why you're here, OK?
This is Laura, 23-year-old female. So Laura was the rear passenger. The driver's lost control, striking the front left-hand side. Laura was wearing a seatbelt. Ops-wise, she sustained a tachycardia at 130 to 150.
A normal resting heart rate is below 100. Laura's rate has been around 150 for many hours, putting serious strain on her heart.
She's got this really fast heart rate and we don't know why. We still don't know if she's got an injury yet.
You guys can go down to recess 3, all the way down past the traffic.
Over in triage, nurse Yasna Cardoza is working her way through a long queue of patients.
Next waiting, thanks.
I love being at triage. You see every single patient that walks in through that door and you're the one that has to decide in that split second where they're actually going to go.
We're flooded. Communication is a big key when it's like this. You're welcome, you're welcome. Last week I was at triage. In an 8-hour shift, on a morning shift, I triaged, I think it was like 110 people in an 8-hour shift. All up for that day, we saw 240 people. Next waiting, thanks. Hi, how are you?
I think I cut half my thumb off doing the dishes.
Nurse Yasna's not only assessing patients through the triage window, she's treating them too.
We'll take this off and I'll have a look. I've got 3 minutes approximately to triage a patient. I need to assess them at the desk in order to figure out where I'm going to allocate them. I just don't want to hurt you. Before you, we won't rip it off, don't rip it off.
The towel is stuck to the wound and Nurse Yasna carefully prises it away. IT manager Klaus was just doing the dishes when an accident happened.
Yeah, just flip your thumb over, yeah. I'm going to put a wet dressing on there so then you don't have to rip it off later. So we take the bandage down and I've watered it with saline just to see what we're dealing with, and it's deep. Okay, ready?
This is
going to hurt because I've got to put pressure on it, okay? Sorry, sir. How did you do it?
Trying to clean the coffee plunger.
So what actually cut you?
Coffee plunger.
The actual coffee plunger?
As Yasna redresses Klaus's thumb, he goes pale and very quiet.
Feeling dizzy right now.
Yeah. Did you want to have a sit down?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll come with you. You hold that. Yeah, let's sit you down. This could end in two ways. He'll either just drop and hit his head, or I've got to catch him. Do you want to have a sit down?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You hold that.
Yeah, let's sit you down.
In triage, Nurse Yasna's dealing with a patient who looks like he's about to pass out.
How are you feeling?
Dizzy.
Just dizzy? Is it from the blunt?
I don't know.
Do you feel like you need to lay down?
I feel like I need to vomit.
Klaus's thumb is bleeding heavily after he cut it cleaning a coffee plunger.
I'm going to get you a vomit bag. It just goes to show how things can change so rapidly. So 1 minute they're okay and then the next they think they're going to faint.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you think you want to lay down?
It helps.
Yeah. Do you think you'd be able to walk to that door and we can lay you down on the bed?
That's right.
So Klaus is pale and sweaty, but you can see his colour slowly coming back. So I need to make sure he's able to get up and get him to a more secure and safe environment.
Yasna moves Klaus to one of the treatment bays.
Are you feeling better laying down now? All right, let me just wrap this up for you. Okay. I need you to take deep breaths for me. So I know it's really sore.
Ah!
Sorry.
Oh.
Sorry. It's just really important for us to put the pressure on so we can stop the bleeding, okay? We'll definitely get you some painkillers. Let me just wipe it down. As you can see, we triage, answer phone calls, and do treatment, as well as coordinate who goes in, who comes out.
Hello, I'm Thomas. I'm another one of the emergency doctors.
Hi, Tom.
How did you do it?
Coffee plunger.
Okay, pop it there and we'll have a look.
Dr. Tom Rasgar examines Klaus's thumb to see how deep the cut is.
Yeah, you're down to bone there. Now,
it's clearly more than just a superficial wound, and the nerves and tendons have potentially been damaged. Kitchen accidents are not uncommon. Broken glasses, broken plates, utensils, they're all reasonably common causes for hand and finger injuries. So we'll pop some local anaesthetic in, try and make it all go numb, and then we'll get the plastic surgeon involved. Can you bend the thumb or not?
I haven't tried and I don't want to.
Have a try.
No, I can't.
Okay. And can you feel me touching the tip?
A little bit.
Doesn't feel normal?
No, it doesn't feel normal.
No, okay. So you've got some nerve damage there as well. All right, so I'm going to pop some local anaesthetic in. In the long term, it might not be like it was yesterday. So he might have some nerve damage. He might have some difficulties with a full range of motion. We'll know a little bit more once his local anaesthetic's worked and we can have a better look at what's working and what's not.
Klaus has sliced through nerves and tendons, and without surgery, might lose the use of his right thumb.
So this is the part that stings. Sorry.
Rex, you gotta keep your head still, darling. Keep your head nice and still, it's okay.
Dr. Miriam has splinted 82-year-old biker Rex's broken leg in preparation for emergency surgery after a serious crash.
Come on. It's okay, it's all right.
You're all right now,
Rex's wife Robin and daughter Belinda are trying to comfort him, but are struggling to hide their emotions.
Are you okay?
He's usually the strong one in the family.
You're on your ride with your mates, on your bike, and you're going around a corner and the bike slid out from underneath you, and then you slid on your butt.
Robin has nursed Rex through many motorbike accidents during their 57-year marriage.
He loves it. He loves it so much that, you know, you couldn't take it away from him. But he's just said that this might be his last bike, which I think I'll be very grateful for.
Dr. Miriam finally has the scan results.
How are you going, Robin?
Okay.
And the news is not good.
In the middle of his back, there's a fracture in one of the bones. So we're getting our orthopaedic surgeons to have a look at that to see how that will be managed. I don't know if it will need an operation or not at this point.
Okay.
Yeah. The options to manage the fracture in his spine may include surgical management, which is obviously very risky.
Because of Rex's age, the surgery to repair his broken back is high risk.
Rex, did you hear any of that?
Some
of it?
Yeah.
So one of the bones in your back is broken?
Yeah.
Yeah. The orthopaedic surgeons, the bone doctors who are looking after your leg, they will also look after your spine as well.
Right.
So we just need to wait for them to come in and see you again and decide what to do.
Okay.
Do you have any questions?
When are you going to take this off my leg?
Right now. How's that?
He's a fighter and he takes everything in his stride. The man of the house, the... just... there, you know he's there, 100%. Would have been hard to lose him at this stage.
IT manager Klaus came into emergency after cutting his thumb so deeply, Dr. Tom Rasgar could see bone.
How did you do it?
Coffee plunger.
It's now being x-rayed to check if the bone itself is damaged.
I know that I need to have plastic surgery and then I will hopefully manage to stitch it back together. Glue it back together, I don't know.
Just come and grab tape for me.
Yeah.
Not having a functional thumb would be very debilitating, so it needs a proper clean-up in theatre to give him the best chance of recovery as possible.
Dr. Tom is hoping Klaus can go to theatre soon, so Nurse Matthew Biles prepares him for the operation.
It'll definitely be stitches. They'll stitch it up. Sometimes, depending on how deep it is, if there's anything inside that needs to be brought together, they may use a dissolvable stitch.
Hello.
While Klaus waits to be transferred to a ward, his young family arrives to lift his spirits.
Look at the band-aid.
It's not a band-aid.
It is.
Looking well, I feel really bad that I need to take this seriously. Yeah. Anyway, I've got your pajamas, a change of t-shirt. I'll put some beer in the fridge.
I can't bring in good news. It sounds like they're fairly keen to do a procedure tonight.
Yeah.
So one of our orderlies will come and take you upstairs.
Okay.
Okay. Sound good?
Sounds good, yeah.
I'll be back shortly.
Klaus is hoping surgery will mean he'll still have full use of his thumb.
One, two, three.
Back in trauma, Dr. Emma West's car crash victim, Laura, is still in a life-threatening condition. She has a worryingly fast heart rate that could be due to internal bleeding.
When someone has a fast heart rate, we want to know whether or not they've got a broken pelvis, because that's probably one of the worst injuries we see, where people bleed internally from a pelvic fracture.
Your parents, are you all okay?
You can come in.
Laura's emotional parents have made the long journey from country Victoria to be with their daughter.
You okay?
It's very frightening as a parent.
Yes.
It's hard seeing your baby land there like that.
So I think to sort out the tachycardia, we just need to do a scan and exclude bleeding.
There's little time for a proper family reunion. Dr. Emma is sending Laura for a CT scan to check for potentially lethal internal injuries.
Have you had a CT scan before?
Yeah. One of the things that's puzzled us is her heart rate is really, really fast, and that's sometimes a marker of internal bleeding.
Oh, okay.
And so we're a bit worried about that.
Yeah.
She's got Graves' disease. The heart just goes 100 miles an hour.
Sometimes she says, "Mom, feel my heart," and it's just
going fast. Okay.
It's the missing piece of the puzzle for Dr. Emma. Now she has to work out if Laura's fast heart rate is due to internal bleeding or her thyroid condition.
When she got this condition,
the Graves. Yeah.
She was so thin, and all her hair was falling out.
Okay.
And yeah.
So this has been a big stumbling block in her life.
It has. Yeah.
So Laura's mum and dad have told me that she has Graves' disease, which is a disease of the thyroid where it's overactive. I really need to think hard about what the cause of her fast heart rate is. The number one cause would be bleeding, particularly in a car accident. But I'm also aware that there are other causes, one of them being Graves' disease.
Can be a little bit of a bump on the way over, okay? Just stay nice and still. Okay, one, two, three.
Dr. Emma heads to the CT scan, where another serious complication to Laura's treatment is developing.
Are we allowed to give IV? Could she be thyrotoxic?
She could be. In the CT scan, so that we can see an injury, we need to inject iodine dye into Laura. And the problem with iodine is it feeds the thyroid, and this could potentially make her thyroid disease worse. But really, if I don't find the bleeding, then I'm not serving her well in terms of trauma care.
So, priorities-wise, she's tachycardic trauma.
Dr. Emma decides to call a specialist to discuss the risks of the iodine dye.
It's Emma West speaking in emergency. Look, I'm seeing a young trauma who has in the recent past been diagnosed with Graves' disease. So we do need to know now-ish if she's bleeding, yes. Worst case scenario is for a patient to have thyroid storm. And in those cases, the heart rate can become out of control and the patient can essentially have a heart attack and die.
Are we allowed to give IV? Could she be thyrotoxic?
She could be.
Dr. Emma needs to rule out life-threatening bleeding for car crash victim Laura, who also suffers from a thyroid condition called Graves' disease. But the thyroid could react to the iodine dye used in the CT scanner.
My hunch is that it is related to either anxiety or thyroid. I'm weighing up the risks. Laura needs contrast given to her so that we can be absolutely sure she doesn't have a traumatic injury. The problem with the contrast is that it contains iodine, which is bad for her thyroid.
And if her thyroid reacts to the dye, she could have a heart attack.
Thanks a lot. Yes, go ahead. The endocrinologist agree with me. They think the benefit of knowing that she's not bleeding far outweighs the risk of the potential worsening of her thyroid disease.
Okay, Laura, that hot injection's coming now. Just try and follow those breathing instructions. You're doing really well.
Please breathe in and hold your breath.
After a tense wait, Laura's thyroid doesn't react to the iodine dye, so she's safe from an imminent heart attack. Dr. Emma and the emergency team are also able to rule out internal bleeding as the cause of Laura's rapid heart rate.
So it's great news for Laura that she doesn't have any internal bleeding, and actually we can't find anything that's concerning from a traumatic injury perspective, which allows us to move to focusing on her thyroid as a cause of her fast heart rate.
Dr. Emma can now share the good news with Laura's parents, Sharon and Greg.
So I've already spoken to the endocrinology doctor. Yep. They are going to come and see your daughter.
Oh,
and
okay.
We'll get a watertight plan for
yeah.
you.
Yeah. We'd just be happy with her to see
someone regularly.
Yeah. Regularly.
So they'll be back in the next sort of 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Dr. Emma is concerned Laura's Graves' disease is not able to be well managed in her small country hometown. She arranges for Laura to receive care from a specialist endocrinologist.
Nice and bumpy for you.
Yeah.
I'm also from a small country town, and when I was growing up, I remember we had a lot of problems getting medical care in our small town. I just really want to ensure everything goes right for Laura, and hopefully she can get her life back on track.
How are you?
How are you feeling? Your heart rate's still pretty fast, isn't it? So I've just had a look through your scans. I can't see any bleeding. That's good, yeah. And your brain scan looks normal as well. I think we've got an opportunity to make a difference. While she's here, we'll try and be a one-stop shop for her and get the follow-up she needs. So she can start the antithyroid drugs when she's in the ward under the trauma team. The thyroid specialists will figure out how much she needs, what type she needs, and what ongoing care she might need.
There's two MVOs coming.
Yep.
One's agitated and doesn't want to be here.
Trauma 1, trauma 2?
Yep, trauma 1, trauma 2.
Come on in.
Dr. Mark's double trauma patients had very different outcomes from their head-on car crash.
At the speed that you came to a stop, things can kind of tear.
The driver underwent emergency surgery to have some of his bowel removed and almost 2 litres of blood extracted from his abdomen. He spent 10 days in hospital.
He's quite uncooperative as if he's affected by it. Oh, look at that. Look at that.
The passenger was kept for observation, but discharged himself a few hours later. The substances recovered from his underpants were taken by police.
Yeah, you're down to bone there.
IT manager Klaus had his thumbs stitched back together.
Look at the Band-Aid.
It's not a Band-Aid.
And he's recovering well. 82-year-old biker Rex was flown to hospital with a badly broken leg and a broken back after coming off his motorbike at high speed. Rex's first memory after the accident was waking up in hospital and seeing wife Robin by his bedside.
Robin appeared out of a cloud. I get a bit emotional about this one. I was so glad to see her.
It's 3 months later, and by wearing a back brace, Rex has avoided a risky back operation. But he's still recovering from major surgery to his leg.
When they put the titanium nail down the leg, they had to go in from behind the knee. And then they had to sort of dislocate the knee and put a drill down there, 12 millimetre, right down the middle of the shin bone, through both pieces and then pin them.
That was a major concern, that he may not be able to walk again.
They're beautiful, aren't they? They are good.
Fortunately, he is. Each week you could see him get better. To start off with, he got rid of the brace for his back and was just walking with his moon version. No, he's done very well for an old fella.
Happily married 57 years, Robin has always supported Rex's passion for motorbikes.
That a heavy hit on gravel, that's a heavy hit to do that.
But Rex is now hanging up his helmet and leathers for good.
The good sense part of my brain, which is a very small section, said to me, give it up, give it up. You've done well, you've crashed your way through 60 years. That's enough.
It was cold, it was raining, it was just a shocking day. Phone rang and Taylor just said, Dad, something terrible's happened.
He survived the accident. What happened to me?
His legs were pinned in the van.
But is his biggest challenge...
It's going to be awful for him.
...yet to come.
He's going to lose his leg. That's the real deal here.
New emergency, next Wednesday on 9.